Welcome to Mount Zion Baptist Church's live stream. Our mission at Mount Zion takes its inspiration from Ezekiel 34:16. I will seek the lost and I will bring back the strayed. With the help of modern technology, we can gather and virtually praise, worship, and minister God's Word. If this is your first time tuning in, we would like to give you a special welcome. You could have picked any church's live stream, but you chose ours, and we thank you for that. Our ministry is to spread God's Word throughout the world, whether it be in person at our church or virtually on your phone, tablet, computer, or smart TV. Make sure to like, subscribe, and share us online at mountzionhudson.org and on social media via Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Twitch TV. Please share this with your family and friends, and thanks again for joining us. We appreciate it, and we appreciate you.
For most of our Oglala people, summertime is known as the white van season. It's where white vans would show up and do a lot of great things, and then the white vans would leave. 12 years ago, I came here on a white van, and just the imprint that the church has of coming and then leaving. I believe the Lord put that in my heart to begin the call for us to come live here for however long He needed us. We are in the southwest corner of South Dakota on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. Pine Ridge is home to the Oglala Lakota people, and we lead the country in everything you don't want to lead the country in. We have 80% unemployment. The teen suicide rate is 300% higher than the national average, and we're still ultimately an unreached people group here in the center of our country. We are absolutely an evangelistic ministry, but our approach is through compassion ministry. We do a free summer camp for our local kids. It's a day camp. We have church groups that help us do camps for typically 8 weeks out of the summer. And then one of the greatest needs we have here is just basic housing needs, water lines, plumbing, electrical. And I've always done construction. You build relationships that way. So it became a pretty big staple for our ministry was just construction outreach. And then the journey of becoming a licensed dentist practice, dental practice. And through all of that, God has blessed us with some amazing churches and teams that have come from all over the country from day one and have helped us do this. And so to make the gospel accessible, our heart was to be consistent, to be here, to be present all year long. And so people here still call it white van season, but now it's different.
Good morning, folks. It's great to be here. It's Palm Sunday today. And y'all know how much I love doing announcements. But we're going to do them anyway. If you're a guest here, there are visitor cards in the back. Would you please grab one? There's one in your pew. You grab one, fill it out, and leave it in the box in the back. That would be great. This afternoon, there's a deacons meeting at 4:30. Also, their newsletters are in the back. In the Welcome Center, also available to you on one of those tables. There's a lot going on with XYZ. We've had a lot of meetings and a lot of planning. XYZ Sunday is going to be May 7th. The former pastor, John Green, will be here, our guest speaker. Lunch will be catered by Boxcar Grill. And for all seniors, it doesn't cost a thing. Just come on and enjoy it. We'd love to have you come. But you need to sign up so we can know how many people need to be fed. There's also an XYZ picnic at the Ponderosa going on Saturday, April 15th. We'll be leaving at 11:30 here from the church. There's details in the bulletin. The community block party we'll be having on June 10th. The sign-up sheet's in the back. Would you please sign up? There's all different areas. And is there anything else I need to add to that, Angie? No.
Good.
the WMU 108th annual WMU meeting and the 25th annual banquet is on Tuesday, April 25th at 6 o'clock at the Life Center of First Baptist Hudson. Another ladies' ministry coming up on May 5th and 6th. It's in your bulletin. You can sign up. You can even register by a link here. See that? It's called Unplug and Reset Women's Retreat. I think it's going to be a great time. And there's some folks that have stuff planned. And I know there's several. They've been working on it for a while. We had one in the fall, and it was great. It was very well attended. I challenge you to come out, get signed up, and come out and be blessed by that. We'll be starting up our food roundup ministry again. Collections in room 119 all the way down to the end of the education building, the second room from the end on the left. We're collecting through April 23rd. Today there's a bridal shower from 2 to 3:30 for Allison Pinnell and Tim Townsend. Would you come out and bless them? I hope you do. Annie Armstrong, as we've seen, is going on. Our goal is $9,000. Given to date is $5,486.09. GAs are having, right after the service today, I hope you have some money on you. They're having a bake sale in the back for exactly that, Annie Armstrong Easter offering. There'll be a sunrise service Sunday, April 9th at 7 o'clock, followed by some biscuits. The ladies in the kitchen, whoever's working, maybe not just ladies, are going to be setting that up. We'll have those. Right after that, we'll have Sunday school at regular time. We'll have worship at 10 at our regular time. That's very next week. There's a children's spaghetti fundraiser lunch going on April 16th, following morning worship. Suggested donation is $7. Are there any other announcement I might be missing? Mr. Mack.
Morning, church. The associate pastor of Children, Youth, and Family Search Committee, which consists of Nikki Stamey, Kendra Weinbarger, Jennifer Phillips, Tamara Hines, and myself, we've been working. And while we don't have a candidate yet, we have been very appreciative of your prayers, and we remain committed to this search. In January, February, and into March, we advertise our job posting on the church's Facebook page, through the print and online versions of the Biblical Recorder, and through the Baptist Associations in Caldwell County and all the counties that touch us. We've been fortunate to receive packets from multiple pastoral candidates and have prayerfully reviewed these candidates. Our original posting gave us a closing date of March 12th. While we have been fortunate to receive packets from many godly men seeking to serve God, we as a committee recognize that God has a specific leader already picked out for our precious young people. And we want to be sure that we have exhausted every avenue and done our due diligence out of respect for what you good people have asked us to do, but even more so for what the Lord would have us do. We will be reopening our job posting and will continue to seek and review resumes from candidates for the time being. We're going to repost on Facebook, and we're going to try at least a few new avenues we haven't tried yet to get our posting further out there. Please continue to pray for us as we seek to follow God's will during this very important process. So, thank you.
I missed something, and Miss Anna reminded me, and she will. You'll remind me, won't you? XYZ have planned a sight and sound trip. It's a sight and sound theater, Moses play is going on at the theater, Amish Country. It's September 18th to 22nd of 2023. There's envelopes that Miss Anna has if you need to get one. There's details to follow. There's a bunch more details. There's a lot of planning, and a lot of it's already been done. The trip is booked for 40 people, so it's going to be a first-come, first-serve basis. And if we can add people, we'll try, but I don't know if we can. We'll see what we can do with that. But if you have any questions, ask Anna. She's in charge of that. Any other announcements this morning? All right. Do we have any birthdays this morning? Do we have any anniversaries? None. Okay. Well, would you stand up and greet each other this morning?
Where? how deep is the Father's love for us that he sent his only begotten Son. Through him we have eternal life.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all
praying church. So the doors open from 8 to 4, Monday through Friday. Ed and Sherry will be here. If you want to come to the church, come to the altar and pray for our church, for anything that you need to pray for. Anything after 4 p.m., we've got a parking lot you can pull in, pray over the church. We just need the prayers for the church and prayers for everybody. So let's make Mount Zion show and be the praying church that we are. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you today thanking you for all the blessings you give us. Thank you for the cross and the resurrection, God. God, thank you for the beautiful weather you've bestowed upon us that we're unworthy of. God, just keep us in your loving, caring hands. God, be with the choir and Pastor Ed as he brings the service today and all the music that we're going to hear. Lord, if there's anyone here that needs you, touch their heart and help us lead them to you, God. Forgive us where we fail you in our daily walks of life. In your holy name we pray, amen.
Thank you. Children, if there are any of you that are not up here this morning, we invite you to please come up and join us for your children's time with Miss Wesley.
Check.
This morning we are going to do something super fun. Are you ready for this? So let me get my stuff out. Okay, so somebody's going to need to stir, and somebody's going to need the spatula, and wait a minute. Okay, I got something extra special for you, so can you hold on just a minute? Okay, hold on just, I tell you what, I'll give it to you, but don't open it yet, okay? Can you do that? No, don't open it. You just have to hold it, okay? Oh, hold on. Perfect. Okay. All right. So let me give you that. Okay. Okay. Now let me see what else is in here. Oh, dear. Catastrophe. Is the right. Okay. All right. Okay. I'm going to give this one to you, okay? You just hold on to that. Okay. And let me see. Somebody's going to need the bowl. Perfect. Perfect, and I'm going to use you in just a minute, Eli, so if you can just hold tight for just a minute. Okay, so what do y'all think we're going to do this morning? We're going to make brownies this morning. So let's see. Miss Jennifer, you got the stove all turned on for us, right, in the back? Okay. Yeah, thank you, Miss Jennifer. Thank you. All right. She's got the stove all turned on for us in the back, so we're going to be ready to do these brownies here in a second. We do need, okay, can you open that for me and see what's in there? It's believe it or not, it screws off. Y'all could, okay, let's just be calm a minute here. Okay, so what, okay, can you get that out? Be easy with that. Be easy with that. Be what? It is an egg. And you get to crack the egg. Into my bowl. Can you crack the egg? Crack it in the egg. Crack it. No. This is Evan's minute to shine. Okay, go ahead. Go ahead. Oh. What? I want you to know this is not a story. This egg has lasted for 4 years. But Evan finally cracked it. It's good. It's all good. What's wrong with this egg?
There's nothing inside.
Hey, buddy, how are you? You think we're a bunch of nuts, don't you? There's nothing inside. Did y'all expect that egg to be empty?
Yes.
Apparently, my whiteout to hide the hole has gone away sometime. Well, really, it's not fake. It really is a real eggshell, and believe it or not, it took a long time for me to get the whole insides out of that, but at one time, there was an egg inside that eggshell. Oh, let's just leave it in there, all right. Okay, so if we're going to make brownies, we expected that we needed an egg in there, right? Because you got to have some eggs to make brownies. Okay, well, today I would like to talk to you about expectations. What is an expectation? Right, they think something's going to be one way, but it's really another. Like, we really thought there was going to be an egg in there for at least a minute. Y'all thought there was an egg in there. Evan held that egg up and I heard, oh no. From somewhere here in the front row. Okay, so there were some people who really expected that thing to have an egg in it because they know me. And so they're like, oh yeah, there's probably an egg in that. So sometimes we expect things to be one way, but they're another. Let me tell you another expectation. When Mr. Dirk got married and he thought of a wife for the rest of his life. He had one expectation. He got something totally different than his expectation. And I have been his cross to bear ever since. I'm telling you, it is rough, rough, rough. Hey, buddy, come here. Oh, you scare me on those steps. Come here. Can we hold hands? Well, there are other people who have expectations, and those expectations don't come. Hey, what's his name? Come here, bud. There we go. There are other people who have expectations that don't quite turn out right. And those crowds that were lying in the streets when Jesus came in and they were waving those palm branches, they had expectations. They expected that Jesus was going to come in and politically overthrow the government. He was going to take everything and make it theirs. He was going to give them everything they thought should have been theirs. It's what we think of as divine retribution. That's what they were wanting. They were not thinking about their souls. They were not thinking about what Jesus was really coming to do. So their expectation was totally wrong. Because you see, kings have come and kings have gone. There have been kings on this earth and presidents and prime ministers and all these people. They come and they go because they're born and they die. Queen Elizabeth. She did die, but she was there a long time, and she was a good monarch, but they only last for a certain amount of time. Jesus wasn't interested in that. That part is not what interests him. It interests him where you spend eternity, and that's why he came. He didn't come to be a conquering king on earth. He came to conquer the grave and conquer sin. Now, I would not be so mean. Speaking of expectations, okay, Eli, I need you now, buddy. Can you come here? I didn't forget you. You don't think I forgot my buddy, do you? Okay, could you open that? Now, what do you think's in here?
A brownie mix.
Okay, can you open that and see what's in there, Eli? But don't dump it out. Just pull one out. What's in there? Real brownie. So let me tell you what I want you to do. Are you ready? Ready? Now listen, we're going to pray, and then Mr. Landon is there. He's going to take all your bacon supplies from you. You just give them to Mr. Landon, and then step right over there, and you can choose a brownie or a cake. All right? Are you ready?
I knew it was going to be brownie mix.
Yeah, because you know me. I know. All right, let's pray. You all know us. Okay, let's pray. Let's pray, Evan. Are you ready? Come pray with me. You ready? All right. Jesus, thank you so much that you love us. Jesus, thank you that you knew we didn't need a king. We didn't need to be freed from political things. We needed to be freed from the grave, Lord. We needed to spend eternity with you. And we thank you for that, dear Jesus. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Okay.
As our children return to their seats, let's please stand together as we sing, "The King is Coming."
Good morning. My name was on a list to sing today, but as you see, I get more people to help me. You know, we're very blessed to be able to assemble and to worship our God. Don't you agree? You know, I'm very blessed to have these people up here sing with me, praising. Especially blessed to have the one on the end to be here at church with me. Not Josh. I do love Josh, though. The one on the end down there. You know, when I sing, everyone singing praise and worship songs and hymnals, I'm just going to tell you this quick story about my mother and my father. My mom, she was 5'2". She might be just a little bit taller than Joyce, not much. She sang like an angel, had a beautiful voice. My father was 6'1". He did not. He couldn't carry a tune in a bucket. But you know what? Every Sunday when I sat next to him, he sang. Because he understood, and I got this from him, he understood that when you sing praises, it doesn't matter what you sound like. Because God is going to take that in and understand that you're praising and worshiping him. So please, don't ever, ever be ashamed to sing. That's just a side note, just something I thought about this morning. Revelation 1:8, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I hope you enjoy it.
I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He shall dwell within them, they shall be his people, and Almighty God will be with them. Shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, and no more pain. The former things are all passed away. He that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. He said unto me, write these words, for they are faithful and true. And it is done. It is done. It is done. It is done. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the Son of God, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, he's everything. Messiah, Jehovah, the Prince of Peace is he. Son of man, seed of Abraham, second person in the Trinity. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. The Son of God, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, he's everything. Messiah, Jehovah, the Prince of Peace is he. The Son of man, seed of Abraham, second person in the Trinity. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. The Son of God, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, he's everything. Messiah, Jehovah, the Prince. beginning and the end. The Son of God, the King of kings, Lord of lords, he's everything. Messiah, Jehovah, the Prince of Peace is he. The Son of Man, seed of Abraham, second person in the Trinity, he is the
myself. One more time. We get to sing that song because Jesus showed up. We celebrated, we sang a song, and we're singing about Hosanna and Palm Sunday. We get to sing that song because Jesus showed up the first time. And we're singing about him showing up as the Alpha and the Omega, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. The first time he showed up, it wasn't so much like that, was it? It wasn't. But he did. He showed up. Have you ever had somebody not show up on you? If you're a manager of a business or run a business and your worker doesn't show up on time, or they don't show up at all, what happens? It's a mess. But Jesus showed up. We're going to be talking about divine appointments this morning. It's the triumphal entry. We're going to be in Mark 11. So if you want to turn your Bibles there, you can. When someone doesn't show up, things don't go according to plans. They just don't. And sometimes, think about this, sometimes God has appointments for us we don't want to keep. We don't want to show up for. Sometimes they don't make any sense at all. We're like, what are you doing, God? When Mount Zion called me to serve as associate pastor of discipleship and education, guess what I didn't plan on? Standing right here today doing this. But I'm here. And sometimes stuff doesn't make sense to us. That's not an appointment I made. That's an appointment for some reason God made. And I don't know why I did. Because I'm not worthy of it. But are any of us? But yet we're here. And you know what? We just celebrated Pastor Steve and lifted up the name of Jesus last week in a great way. It was an awesome service. And I don't think Pastor Steve, when I came here, planned on being in Asheboro, North Carolina today, being installed as a new pastor there, I think he planned on being here the rest of his life. And I would love that. I think y'all would have too. But sometimes when God makes plans, we resist him. And what happens? Bad things happen. And Pastor Stephen told me, he said, I'll tell you what, when he broke the news to me finally, and I kind of had an idea what was going on for a little while, and when he finally broke the news to me, he said, listen, if I stay here, it's going to be bad for all of us, because God's called me someplace else. He's made a new place for me and a new home for me, a new mission for me. And he said, if I stay here, it's going to be bad for all of us. And as ridiculous as that sounded to me, and I didn't want to see Stephen leave, here we are. So getting back to an old story of what happened to us, when we were called to Tennessee and pray for that place, the county that we were in, so far from the tornadoes, 9 people have died in that county, right in the town where we served. So pray for those folks. None that I know of so far, but some of their houses are destroyed. Churches are flattened right down the road from where our church was. That's an appointment nobody ever wants to make. But when we got there, we started wondering why God led us to this place. And nothing, I love you folks there over in Tennessee. We were wondering why. It didn't seem like they wanted us there. We were Yankees. We didn't fit in. We talk funny. And I still do. I talk fast. Sorry. And I play guitar. That's what he said. I had one guy say, "We got a Yankee playing guitar in our church." Oh, no. Thanks for reminding me, Dirk. But we weren't welcomed exactly as warmly as we have been here. We have been welcomed by this church. And I love this church. I love y'all. I love Stephen. And I wish him the best. But it didn't seem like a good fit for us there. It just didn't. And after about 2 years, I started saying, all right, I'm starting to be led to send my application elsewhere. The youth group was struggling that we were called to be. I was called to be a youth pastor there. Youth group was struggling. It didn't seem like they had done anything with them for a long time. It just wasn't the best of situations. And around 2 years later, I got a call from church saying, hey, we want you to come. And it was all the way in the east, past where we just were in eastern North Carolina. And it seemed to be a great fit. Everything seemed to be right, but there was a little inkling of there was problems in the church. And we went there, visited, and everything went great. The search committee loved us, we loved them, everything went great. It seemed great, but there was a few people that just didn't seem like they wanted us there. And the pastor resigned right before we got there, which was odd. That happened to me in Tennessee, too. See, I've been through this. But we got back home, and I thought everything went great, but it just seemed there was something a little off, and I got a call from the chair of the search committee, and she said, it didn't work out. It didn't work out. The church didn't call you. And I was like, huh? And she was like, I felt the same way. It didn't make sense to me. But then she said, well, you remember the guy who was leading the youth group? He's one of our deacons, and his dad is the chairman of deacons, and he really wanted that position. And before you got here, we had a vote, and the church voted, and it was real close, and the church was divided on it, and they really wanted him, and it had nothing to do with you. So I was like, all right, well, God, what next? Well, that very next Wednesday night at our church youth group, I would always preach a message on Wednesday night, just like I would here, not too much different. Give an invitation. And I'm like, why, God? Why did this fall through? Because it seems so good. 9 kids prayed to receive Christ that Wednesday night. All right, so God's got that had a different appointment. My appointment was I wanted to go there. Didn't work out. Me and Olga were sitting in there, and at that time, they didn't think we needed any help in the youth group. It was just me and Olga. She did the slides for me, and I did the preaching. 9 kids prayed to receive Christ. We're like, all right, what do we do with this? There's only 2 of us, and there's 9 of them. Next week, a few more. The next week, a few more. Over 30 kids got baptized in that church that year. If I hadn't listened to God, and that, for whatever reason, God told that church not to listen to that. We didn't go there, and there was like a revival. Our youth group was 15 kids when we got there. We're up to about 45 kids. We didn't know what to do with ourselves. We had more people serving up in the youth room than we had all around the rest of the church on a Wednesday night. It was amazing. God had a different appointment for us. So he wasn't done with us there. We thought we were, but we weren't. So we come along and had this. It was forced on us. Sometimes God forces us into situations we don't plan, we don't want. I'm here. I didn't plan this. So what about you? Now I gave you my story, some of my story. What about you? Enough about me. You may be wondering about your situation today, why you're in this situation. God, why am I here? Why am I going through this struggle? Why am I going through this grief? Why does my job stink? Or whatever, I don't know. Why did so-and-so break up with me? Why is my marriage in shambles? I don't know what it is for you today. But But God has a plan for everything that goes on. I've learned that in my life. And he has an appointment set for you. And we have a choice sometimes whether or not to show up. Sometimes God forces his hand. But every single one of us in this building today, every single one of us, God has an appointment for. God has a plan. And why we're here, there's no accident why we're here. So what about Jesus? Let's get off of me and us. What about Jesus? God had an appointment for a son. Did he not? And Jesus showed up. That's why we can know that he's going to show back up again. Like he said, when we said the king's coming. He is. We sing that with assurance. And every single believer in this room is proof of that. Because he came. And he died on a cross. And he paid a price. And that appointment was a cross, essentially. I mean, a triumphal entry we're going to be talking about today. I mean, it seemed like a great thing. It didn't seem too good on Friday morning, did it? No. So let's take a look at the backstory. As Jesus was telling his disciples, and the disciples didn't understand a lot of things, and neither do we when things are going on in our lives that don't make sense. So in Luke 18, and this is in our scripture for today, Jesus took the 12 aside and told them, "We're going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written by the prophets about the Son of Man will be fulfilled. He will be delivered over to the Gentiles. They will mock him and insult him and spit on him. They will flog him and kill him. On the third day, he will rise again." The disciples didn't understand any of it. Now, we don't like some appointments we have. I mean, I don't like going to the dentist, but this is a lot worse than the dentist, going to a cross. And Jesus knew. He told them again and again, "I'm going there." And the disciples didn't like it either. They're like, "Oh, no." What did Peter say? "Oh, no, Jesus, not you. We're not going to let that happen." What did Jesus say? "Get behind me, Satan." He rebuked him. Peter tried to rebuke Jesus. Didn't go too well. Jesus had a plan. He orchestrated the whole thing. He was following the Father's plan. Because the disciples all knew this. Jesus kept saying, and they knew what was going on. Everybody in Jerusalem, all the Jews, were seeking to how they could find a way to kill Jesus. And they're like, "What are you, nuts, Jesus? Why would you want to go there?" Jesus isn't nuts. He doesn't make mistakes like we do. He had an appointment to keep for us. And he has appointments for us. In life, I don't know what that is for you today. I'm not all-knowing. He is. But the question is, are you going to show up for that appointment that God has called you to? Jesus didn't turn and run. He showed up. That's why we could celebrate today. That's why we have hope today. Assurance. He knew how badly that appointment was going to go. Did he not? He told them, "They're going to flog me. They're going to spit on me. They're going to mock me. And they're going to kill me." Now, if I told you this, "I have an appointment for you tomorrow, and they're going to flog you and spit on you and kill you," you'd probably say, "I think I'm going to call in sick." And so would I. But if he was willing to show up for that, why would we not be willing to show up for that person that he has us to share the gospel with, for serving in a ministry in the church? I don't know. I don't know what is your appointment with him is. There's probably many. But if you're able, would you stand with me for the reading of God's word? We're going to read about the triumphal entry. Mark 11, 1 through 11, out of the NIV. It says, "As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, 'Go into the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you doing this? Say the Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly. They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.' Blessed is the coming King of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Let's pray. Father God, we love you, Lord. We thank you for your love and your word. We thank you for Jesus who showed up for us, Lord, in a way that most of us would never show up. We thank you for it, Lord. Change us for it, Lord. Lead us to where you would have us to be today, tomorrow, next week, next year. And let us show up when you call us, Lord God, and serve where you call us. And be obedient. Change us, Lord. Don't leave us the same way we were when we came in here today. We love you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So first thing we see is, and it's not really, you got to read between the lines, ahead of here, God made an appointment for his son. God the Father made an appointment for Jesus' son. The one for by him and through him, all things were created, God made an appointment. And we know the verses that where God says it. We should all know these verses. Maybe you don't, but it says this, for God so loved the world that he gave his own one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. That was Jesus' appointment. How it happened for him was not exactly fun. We know that. It was a divine appointment. And what was it really? It was God keeping his promise. We talked about promises in Sunday school, if you're in my class. God keeps his promises. If he's called you and saved you, he promises to keep you to the end. If you're genuine, of course. But God kept his promise. Is that an appointment any of us would want to keep? If we're the ones that were the object of that promise, you're going to go and you're going to save them, and it's going to cost you your life, and it's going to cost you your dignity, and they're going to mock you, and they're going to spit in your face and call you names. We probably wouldn't even want to be spit on or called names, let alone go to a cross for people who by the end of the week were going to be screaming, crucify him. But he did. So then we get to this odd point, and I was talking to somebody about this sermon the other day, and Jesus made an appointment for his disciples. You're going to go in the city, you're going to go find a colt, you're going to grab the colt, you're going to untie the colt, you're going to take him, and if anybody asks you what's going on, say the Lord sent me to do it. That would be like us, like if I said, from the pulpit here, I want you to go into town, go down to the car dealership, grab a car, take it, and if they tell you, what are you doing, tell them, the preacher said to do it this morning. See how that works out? It's not going to work out well. They're probably going to call the police and you're going to get arrested. But sometimes the Lord, like I said, he sets appointments that don't make sense. It didn't make sense to the disciples. Jesus, why are you going back there? They want to kill you there. Even his brothers, they were basically saying, Jesus, you're nuts. Why would you go there? They're going to kill you. Stop it. Stop what you're doing. Sometimes God makes appointments for us that don't make sense. Sometimes God makes appointments for us that we don't feel equipped for or we feel worthy of. I want to tell you a story about a young lady. And her name is Jill, and my wife knows who she is, and my kids know she is. We went to Guatemala the first year we went to Guatemala. And we went down there. We didn't know exactly what was going to go on, but we went to the school, and we were sharing the gospel in the school. There was like 700 kids, and we were going in the class. Like, they wouldn't let us do it here in our country, but they let her go, us all go into this school and share the gospel with these kids every single day. It was awesome. School of 700. And she was one of my students in the youth group. And I scheduled for her. I was going to certain classrooms and sharing the gospel, and I said, you're going to be the other one. The rest of them were doing games with the kids and different things. We're doing backyard Bible club type things like that. You know, she said to me, I'm scared to death. I ain't going in there. After she already agreed to it, but she didn't really want to. I'm scared to death. I can't do that. I just tried to encourage her. I said, you know what? I asked you because I think there's something in you. God's calling me to ask you to do this. She didn't want to go. I encouraged her. I don't know what to say. I don't feel like I'm the right person for this. I just encouraged her. I didn't give her an option. She just had to go. I was just like, well, I already scheduled you. You've got to go. Well, I'm sitting there. I'm finished with my class. Several kids receive Christ. Their teacher does too. Awesome. She comes out of that classroom. I mean, couldn't contain that smile. 24 kids just received Christ. I said, didn't I tell you? She showed up for that appointment. She didn't want to, but she showed up. And 24 kids received Christ because she was obedient to show up when I asked her to. 24 kids, she said. She couldn't believe it. When we got done at the end of that day, she said, I can't get wait to get into the next classroom tomorrow. And more showed up the next day. I mean, it wasn't of us. It wasn't anything special that we did. God showed up. He called her to that appointment. He called me to that appointment. And that week, 175 people received Christ, or at least prayed to receive Christ. That's awesome. And I think every single one of us has an appointment with somebody to share Christ with. And God will work if we're obedient. Not all of us are all the time. So is God telling you to do something, that no matter how ridiculous or foolish it sounds, or whether you don't think you're ready to do it? If God's calling you and you obey Him, He'll bring the fruit. I promise you. So they brought Jesus that colt, and they were like, this is just absolutely nuts. They brought Jesus that colt, and this was a fulfillment of prophecy. Zechariah 9:9, he says, this is how it's going to happen. He's going to come in on a colt, a donkey's colt. He's going to come into the city. I don't know why they didn't remember it. And none of us would have planned it that way. Because the Jews thought, what did the Jews think of the Messiah? He was going to come in and be this conquering king that we just talked about, right? And Wesley talked about it. Did Jesus come in as a conquering king? Not even close. He came in on a donkey's colt. They're waving palms at him like we did this morning. That was awesome. Kids and adults who were involved in that, it was powerful. It was awesome. He didn't enter Jerusalem the way they expected him to. And that was his appointment. Because you know what would have happened if he entered Jerusalem the way they expected him to? They would have accepted him. And they wouldn't have crucified him. Can you remember, did anybody know someone else who entered his city as this great religious figure with pomp and all this regalia and this conquering king? His name was Muhammad. And I fear to think that if he showed up the way he did in Mecca, in Jerusalem, they would have been like, there's our Messiah. But when Jesus showed up the way he did, and he didn't wind up being the king that they expected, this guy that was going to overthrow Rome and kick him out of Jerusalem, that's when they rejected him. Because what happened at the beginning of the week, just like us, they were waving palm branches. Hosanna in the highest, King of heaven, Hosanna in the highest. What does that mean? Lord, save us. They were calling him Lord. They were accepting him right at first as the Messiah. But when he didn't turn out to be the guy that they expected, they rejected him. And that's the reality. If Jesus had entered like Muhammad or some other conquering king, they would have said, okay. And guess what would have happened? He wouldn't have went to the cross, and every single one of us would still be in our sins. Wow. So he set an appointment for that crowd too. They had an appointment when he rolled, when he came in on that donkey's colt, on these cloaks. He didn't even have a saddle, I mean, like a nice leather saddle. They just draped some coats and clothes over the donkey. And he rode in, and they were celebrating. And things didn't go as planned. And that celebration was foreshadowing for when he comes back again, of course. But then by Thursday, they arrested him. Judas betrayed him. Friday morning, Pilate tried to give him back Barabbas, and they were like, no, crucify him. We want him crucified. He's not the one. That had to happen, or we'd all be in our sins. He had an appointment for them. And God used their rejection and that horrible negativity and his mocking and being spit on and persecuted to save us. But most of all, and we've already touched on it, Jesus kept his appointment knowing what it meant. None of us would do this, would you? I mean, I love y'all, but I don't think I'd go into Jerusalem this tomorrow morning and let them spit on me and kick me and beat me and whip me over the head and tie me to a cross for you and nail me to a cross. I would like to think I would, but I probably would fail. He didn't. Jesus showed up. I probably wouldn't. Most of us probably wouldn't. He showed up. You know why? And get this now. We just sang a song. How deep the Father's love for us. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice. Call out among scoffers. It was my sin that held them there. Till it was accomplished. He had an appointment with my sin. He had an appointment with your sin. He had an appointment on that cross. And he showed up in that for that appointment in that city to deal with our sin with his life. And you know what else he faced on the cross? We sang about it in that song. The Father turned his face away. I think that was the most painful thing for Jesus. That his Father, his perfect Father that he was in perfect fellowship with, saw him as our sin and had to turn his face because he couldn't face his son. 2 Corinthians 5:21, it says, God had him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That's the appointment Jesus kept, folks. My sin, your sin, upon his shoulders, nailing him to that cross until it was accomplished. And I know it's finished. That's why I could sing all these great songs about Alpha and Omega, and the King is coming, about the future, because he showed up the first time. We know he's going to show up for the second time. But he didn't stay dead. Mm-mm. He told them that. I'm not going to stay dead. They didn't understand it. So that's why the disciples objected. He didn't stay dead. But guess what? The disciples didn't understand this. They spent years with Jesus. Can any of you say that you spent years with Jesus, physically walking around the earth and having him pour into you and teach and disciple you personally? No. They did, and they didn't get it. But if you've trusted in Jesus Christ this morning, and you've been saved, and you have faith in Jesus Christ, you do. That's awesome. We have something they didn't. And God sets all kinds of appointments for his people. And they might be things we don't understand, like I said. It might be something for the first time today. It might be an appointment with you saying, I've never really trusted in Jesus Christ. I've never really made it to that appointment to lay my sins at the cross and trust in Jesus Christ and be saved. I encourage you today, if he's doing that today, do it. And he'll save you. He promises so. He went to a cross. He showed up to this appointment to get you there if you need to be. And I encourage you. If you need to respond to Jesus as Messiah and Savior and Lord, show up like Jesus did. So he has an appointment for you to receive that wonderful news if that's you for the first time today. He came to seek and to save the lost, and if that's you, he'll save you. He promises he'll reach out to you and he'll welcome you. His church will welcome you. And he came and he proved it. He came to seek and to save the lost, and he died on that cross. He made that appointment so that anyone who would be believed would be saved. And he orchestrated this whole thing, this whole triumphal entry to accomplish salvation for us, for anyone who would believe it. And he kept his appointment. He showed up. So now I put that on you again. Is God calling you to something? I don't know what it is. It may be the appointment you already kept. You already received Christ. You already trust in him. But there are still other appointments he might have for you, are there not? I don't know what it is. It might be to follow in believers' baptism and trust in Jesus Christ. It might come to come before Mount Zion Baptist Church and say, I've not become a member of this church, and I need to become a member of this church today. Maybe it's serving in the choir, Dirk. Maybe it's serving on the praise team. Maybe Mark Irvin's going to ask you like he asked me and Josh to come up and sing with me. And Josh are like, why? You guys are the ones that are quartet. It might be serving in the nursery. It might be serving in the children's building. It might be serving in the youth. It might be serving in the kitchen. It might be serving in the parking lot or our security team. It might be cleaning the bathrooms. I don't know. Might be children's ministry. It might be WMU. It might be Baptist men. We had an awesome meeting. And you know what? We had a new leader in Baptist men led us on Friday night. And you know what God told us? He called every single one of us to appointment. We need to be evangelizing the lost. That's the most important thing we could do. That's an amazing thing. He might be calling you to be, hey, how can I be, ask Nikki, how can I be involved in Sunday school? Can I serve somewhere in Sunday school? You might get a call, hey, you've been nominated as a deacon. Or you might get a call, hey, you've been nominated on one of these search committees. We got enough of them. We got plenty to fill. You get the point. God's constantly calling us to show up. But like I said, with this men's meeting, it might be a person. It might be that person that needs to hear the gospel and God's plan for you to share it. It might be a call to missions. It might be a call to a foreign country. You've been there, haven't you? And you're probably saying, God, what in the world do you call me to this for? I don't want to do that. It might be a call to pastoral ministry. I don't know. It might be some business you have to deal with God today. It might be just to come up at the altar and pray to God for a family member, your love, you're grieving, or someone's sick. I don't know what that is, but you do. And if God's calling you, I challenge you and encourage you to respond and show up like Jesus did, because he did. And because he did, we can. And I challenge you to do that. You can. And you know what? As you show up and you show up and serve or wherever it is in it, I know the church that I'm in. We're going to welcome you. We're going to love you. We're going to respond to you. We're going to say, hey, is there something else we can get you to do? Show up. Jesus did. That's why we have hope. That's why we have assurance. So I'm going to ask you to bow your heads. Father God, we come to you today, Lord. We thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your son. Thank you for your calling. Thank you for your message and your word and everything about that you've had and been involved in our lives, Lord. Thank you for our church. We thank you for our salvation. We thank you for the cross. Lord God, I come to you today, Lord, and I thank you for being with us, Lord, and I thank you for your Holy Spirit that resides in us as we trust in you, Lord God, and you impress in our hearts where we need to be and where we need to show up, Lord God. I pray that we would, Lord. Change our hearts, change our minds, Lord. Give those who need courage to come out and step out in faith and follow you, even if it means stepping out in front of everyone else to do so. Lord, we know you're almighty and you're all powerful, and we thank you. We pray all this. In Jesus' name.
Please stand together, and like Pastor Ed said, Jesus is calling. Please respond to his call this morning.
For you and for me.
calling you somewhere today? Is he calling you to serve? Is he calling you to trust him? Is he calling you to someone to share with him? I challenge you to do that this morning. Let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Father God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for your love. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the cross, Lord. We thank you for this great time we have together, Lord God. Let us not be lazy. Let us not be comfortable. Let us go and follow you where you call us and make those appointments and show up just like you said. We thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you so much for your love. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we prepare to leave this morning, let's be singing again on this Palm Sunday, the King is coming.
Thanks for joining us at Mount Zion Baptist Church. Join us again next week for live worship.